Penguin Random House Audio presents That's Not How We Do It Here, a story about how organizations rise, fall, and can rise again, by John Kotter and Holger Rathgeber. Read for you by Bahni Turpin with John Kotter.
The vultures had mysteriously turned from scavengers to killers. No one knew why. These awful, scary, deadly creatures were probably the final blow that was leading to the collapse of Matt's clan. Matt was a meerkat, those smallish African animals that humans seem to find cute and interesting. Matt, like all cats, had his own distinct personality and skills. He had always been shy and could be a bit too rigid once he had a plan in mind. But an inherent sense of loyalty, a soft smile, and skills he always used to help the group had made him much appreciated. He had usually enjoyed life, and most of the time, life had enjoyed him back. But then, because the rain seemed to have disappeared, his clan of fuzzy little creatures no longer had enough food for everyone. At least once a day, Matt ate less so the young and old and weak could have more. But that hardly made even a small contribution to solving the problem. The increase in the number of predators was, well, Matt had never seen anything like it. A few cats said it was all connected. Less rain meant less food, which was leading to strange and unpredictable changes in predator behavior. But who knew for sure? They could not seem to agree upon, much less bring alive, any new big ideas to deal with the new problems. For Matt and many others, that was incredibly frustrating. Making matters even worse, getting the most routine daily work done was proving more and more difficult. It was not as if Matt never had any promising new ideas. He had two very creative friends, Tanya and Ago, who had come up with a possible way to find more food and waste less, and a potential method of spotting predators faster than before. But both cats ran into a wall of, "That's not the way we do things here," a reaction that, considering the circumstances, made no sense. Matt tried to pitch in and show others why such an argument was illogical. He talked to cats he knew the best, those born in litters about the same time as he was. He talked to his family chief, and he got nowhere. Matt was so tired because he was respected. He was asked by one of the big bosses, an alpha, to take on this project and that project and another. The toll on him added up. He was not at all the type who walked through his days quietly or loudly, angry at the world. Yet, here he was, one very mad meerkat.
Hello, everyone. I'm John Kotter, and this is a story about important issues almost all of us are now facing. The rate of change is going up. That fact can be hard to see clearly or to deal with well. And when we cannot find ways to avoid hazards, grasp opportunities, and produce the results we all truly value, all of which we know is possible because some people do it. When we can't, well, life can become quite unpleasant. Now, we've chosen a fable format here, a story with a whole cast of characters, including Matt, because fables can take on big issues and be useful for many people. And the issues here really are big. To understand how we can get better outcomes, we need to more clearly see how organizations rise, why they eventually struggle no matter their past success, and why they can fall. We need more clarity about how a few rise once again to grow, fulfill their mission, create new jobs and services and wealth. It helps to see the role of discipline, planning, reliability, and efficiency in these stories, and the role of passion, vision, engagement, speed, agility, and culture. And there's the very fundamental issue of management versus leadership. And the latter, not just from a few people in big corner offices. Now, yes, we know that this is a bit much for a short book. And yes, many others have had much to say about these issues. But we think there's a lot of fog around some fundamental points here that relate to success today. Only when we begin to lift that fog do we have any chance of turning 21st century challenges and threats into truly exciting opportunities for our businesses, governments, nonprofits, and ourselves. Now, I could go on and on talking about the many decades of research underlying the ideas and insights in this story, but a discussion of that here could undermine our goals of being short, thought-provoking, useful, and fun. At the end of the book, I will offer some thoughts about the issues raised in that research and in this story. For now, enough. Let's go back and start from the beginning of the story.
Chapter 1. Once upon a time, there was a most interesting clan of animals that humans call meerkats. They lived in the Kalahari, a warm and dry stretch of land in the southern part of the African continent. At first glance, the piece of land these meerkats called home looked like many other areas around them. But with a mix of cleverness, hard work, hustle, and a bit of luck, their ancestors had found a place that was not like all the others. A brush fire had cleared the ground before their arrival and had created a nearly perfect habitat. Many predators had been driven away by the fire, and there was plenty of food, which mostly consisted of scorpions, crunchy insects, worms, eggs, and from time to time some fruits. The clan started with a dozen cats and grew to more than 150, a remarkable size that is far from typical. Meerkats can have between 2 and 4 litters a year, with 3 to 5 pups per litter. If you do the math well, the difference between 2 litters and 4 and between 3 and 5 little ones in each is, let's say, that the right conditions can make a lot of additional meerkats. None of these conditions is more important than keeping the clan functioning well, which, as you might expect, turns out to be a more and more difficult task as it grows larger and larger. But this group had learned to manage themselves exceptionally well, which is one of the reasons their story is so interesting. Last spring, they had enjoyed good rain. Finding food was relatively easy. Life was not without its demands, but overall it was good. Everyone had his or her place, and as long as you did things the way they were supposed to be done in the clan and stayed out of trouble, things were pretty fine. Could this change? Of course, almost everyone would say. Change is just a part of life. You have a dry season and then it changes to a rainy season. We have hawks trying to get us sometimes. Then it changes to snakes. But we know how to deal with this. It can be tricky, but we have methods that can handle challenges like that pretty darn well. Thank you. Nadia, the creative one. Nadia was a bright, adventurous, and energetic member of the clan. She had an outgoing personality and an enthusiasm that was infectious, especially around meerkat children, who seemed to want to follow her everywhere. That was usually fun for her, although, as one might expect, it could occasionally be annoying. When Nadia heard that she had to see her family chief at noon one day, she was understandably a little apprehensive. She had almost never had a one-on-one meeting with him. She talked to her friends. Did they know what the meeting was about? One did. Nadia learned that she was being considered for the job of an older sister, for a litter that would soon be able to leave its burrow. After some thought, Nadia decided she very much wanted the job. But first she had to pass an interview with her family chief, who was making all appointment decisions for her group. She was early for her meeting, so she sat down and let her mind wander.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.